Another Dooley Noted podcast comes to you from the Coach's Podcast Room at Spurrier's Gridiron Grill in Celebration Point.
Okay, and welcome in to another Dooley Noted podcast presented by our good friends at Titan MRI and coming to you from the Meldon Law Gator Studio here at Steve Spurrier's Gridiron Grill. We'll have Coach Spurrier on a little bit. Robbie Andrew will also join us for Yes, Nowhere, Maybe, as he always does. So Mondays are pretty much set this year, but next week, by the way, we will not have a Thursday show because I'm going to a funeral up at Arlington Cemetery. It's going to be pretty cool. I'll tell you all about it when I get back. Karen's dad passed away almost 2 years ago, but it takes that long for you to get it approved to go to Arlington Cemetery. So that's going to be something totally different, something I've never experienced. Although I think when I was a kid, I think they took us to the Eternal Flame, the Kennedy thing. I think I can barely remember it. I think I did. Anyway, but this Thursday, I think we're going to have Danny Werfel on. I'm pretty sure we're going to have Danny Werfel on. In fact, Danny Werfel will be on Thursday. So look forward to that. That's always great to talk to him about. Not only he's got his golf tournament coming up, obviously, but some of the great games he played in that were Florida, South Carolina. Of course, with that being a game next week. One of them we'll cover in our Pat Dooley Storytime, too. I got several South Carolina stories. I don't know which one. I may tell two of them. How about that? We'll give you two for the price of one. All right, let's get to our Process Service of Gainesville Starting Five, brought to you by the Process Service of Gainesville, Scott Hart, all the great work he does over there. Number one, okay, Florida won. They did what they had to do. The third quarter wasn't anything to write home about for either team. It was not the most exciting game in the world, but the fans showed up. I give them a lot of credit for showing up for a game like that. And they got the job done. They won the way they needed to win. And they did what they had to do. They got some breaks. You know, the guy had a touchdown pass that he dropped. He could have caught it. Would have kept the score closer. And Vandy's clearly not as good as they were a year ago. They've fallen off a little bit. So the good thing about it was Montrell Johnson kind of took over the game with Etienne out. And Florida is really banged up. Now, I don't know how many guys, we'll find out as the week goes on, are going to be able to be back for this game. But, you know, for example, you know, not having Kingsley, not having Etienne, not having I think Barber was out. They were missing like four or five starters. We'll see how good they are to go. But I think that did kind of show itself. Again, this is not a very deep team. They have a lot of players, but they're all freshmen and sophomores. So when they lose one of those guys that they think is good enough to start, you're turning to another freshman who maybe doesn't have, and they're trying to get a lot of these guys reps so that they're ready for it. But, you know, Nunnery played a ton in that game Saturday night. So, anyway, we'll see where, you know, obviously Vanderbilt's not very good this year. They're not the team that we saw last year that beat Florida and beat Kentucky. But again, they were in the swamp. Crowd was really good, really loud. You know, Borningham had a big game. That was, you kind of had been hearing about that all spring, in summer camp. We've been hearing how good this guy was going to be and that, the announcer, I think it was Dave Neal was doing the game. Dave Neal accidentally called him Zipper at one point of the game, who, of course, is out for the year with a knee, and he's taking his place and doing really well. All right, so that's number one on the Process Service of Gainesville Starting Five. Number two, Florida is 4-2 now. But here's where the schedule gets really hard. Not only because four of the last six are away from the swamp. One's in Jacksonville, but the three, you got to go to Baton Rouge, you got to go to the two Columbias, and you get Arkansas and FSU here. So, I mean, it's not just because of the fact that schedule was a little front-loaded with home games, but a lot of it is because of who you're playing. And think about this, Florida just played the first six games, first half of the season, where they played three ranked teams that are still ranked, right? Kentucky's still ranked? Yeah, because Kentucky's still ranked. Utah's still ranked. Tennessee's still ranked. We were ranked at the time they played them and still ranked. And now the schedule gets hard. That's how tough their schedule is. You know, we saw going in season. Again, people go, well, you got South Carolina this week, 2-3. You know, South Carolina is good enough to beat Florida. We know that. And South Carolina is actually the favorite. I looked it up. I was curious about this. So the first six games of the year that Florida played, the opponents are right now 16-18, well below 500. Well, yeah, but McNeese is 0-6, and Charlotte's 1-5, and that's where a lot of that comes from. But certainly the schedule was still difficult. It wasn't as bad as it is now. And, of course, Vanderbilt to close it out. But the schedule they're going to play in the last six games, 24-10 is their record, and that includes, like, Arkansas has, I think, got three losses. So, I mean, this schedule is really going to be tough, and it's going to be – look, I think bowl eligibility is the goal right now. It's the only goal. Try to get to a bowl game. And you got to win two more games. So when are you going to win them? Well, this might be an opportunity, but this team never plays good on the road. So we're just going to sit and watch and see what happens. Maybe things will change. Maybe they'll start playing well on the road. Number three on the process service of Gainesville starting five was the Miami blunder, Miami mishap, whatever you want to call it. But, I mean, so Karen's out of town. Karen is in Colorado at a convention. But her sisters, two sisters and their husbands, came over after the game to watch football with me. They like to watch football with me, and we had a good time. And but the Miami game is over. We turn it off. They wanted to go to bed. I was going to go in my office, watch a little more football. And then all of a sudden I'm sitting there and I'm like, what did that score say? What in the – what? So then I had to go racing around trying to find out what happened. And if you didn't watch it or you don't know about it, you know, I think everybody knows about it by now. They just had to kneel one play and the game is over. Instead, they handed it off. Guy fumbled. I still haven't seen the fumble. I mean, I've seen it, but I don't know if he wasn't down or not. But anyway, they fumble. And then Georgia Tech goes 75 yards in two plays. Guy's wide open behind the defense, gets a touchdown, and they win the game. And you're just sitting there going, with 1 second to go, what? So I wish I'd seen it live, but this is why you don't turn games off, I guess. I need to learn my lesson. I did enjoy a great day of watching football. It was a lot of fun. But, man, that was bad. And that's one that's going to be hard to explain, really hard to explain to your fan base. All right, let's get to number four on our process service of Gainesville starting five. All right, Kentucky, Kansas, UCLA, Duke, North Carolina, Louisville. What do they all have in common? Basketball schools, right? They're all ranked in football. What the H? Is this NIL? Is this transfer portal? I mean, what is going on? Cats and dogs living together. It's the first time it's ever happened where those schools were all ranked in the AP Top 25. All considered to be basketball schools. But, I mean, Kentucky has had, obviously, success. Kansas, with Leopold's doing really well. UCLA, you know, with Chip Kelly, who's almost a coach at Florida. And, of course, Duke is to me, one of the big surprises. And Louisville's big win, too. It's possible to be good in both sports. Now, the sad thing is nobody's ever been as good as Florida was in two sports when Florida won national championships. In 3 years, they won, obviously, four national championships total in football and basketball. We know that story, okay? You don't have to repeat it, Pat. But Florida's not good at either one right now. Right now, Florida has these two new coaches that are trying to work their way in to a situation. And you know, I mean, I think football is on the right track. I think basketball might be pretty good this year, but right now you could technically say, well, you didn't go to the tournament, you went to a crummy bowl game in Las Vegas and got killed. Anyway, that's not the point. The point is it's possible to be good in both, certainly. I mean, all you have to do is devote the energy and the time and the money to doing it, which is what Kentucky did with Mark Stoops. It's what Kansas did with Lance Leopold, which I thought was a great hire when he made it. Anyway, all right, that is number four on our process service of Gainesville starting five. Let's get to number five, which was we had some baseball last night. The Rangers won. They are up 2-0 on the Orioles. Man, you'd hate to see a season that was so great where the Orioles kind of came out of nowhere and all of a sudden were good. You know, and for those of us who don't watch a lot of baseball during the regular season, we kept looking at scores going, man, what's going on here? And to lose it would not be good. The Twins won, beat the Astros. Correa beat up on his old team. So there, that is 1-1. We'll give you the games that are going to be played for the rest of this week when we get to our swamp games of the weekend. Obviously, the Braves are playing a little bit later today. I'm a little discouraged. I mean, the one thing I was worried about with the Braves was their pitching, and then they lose the first game 3-0. Okay, so I should have been worried about the greatest lineup in the history of baseball. They all of a sudden can't hit. So anyway, but I'll get to that in a little bit. All right, that's going to do it for our process service of Gainesville starting five. We appreciate all of our great sponsors, and we will come back again with Coach Spurrier. Always love talking to him. Here on another Duly Noted podcast, presented by Titan MRI from the Meldon Law Gator Studios.
This Tuesday at the Gainesville Quarterback Club, we welcome Gator great Chris Doering, current SEC Network host and college football analyst, always has great insight for our club members. Then we take a break and welcome another Gator great, James Bates, also a college football analyst and professor at the University of Florida. James is always fun to have at the club, so look forward to seeing him.
Things have certainly got a little out of hand lately when it comes to just buying our everyday necessities. Just look at gas, streaming services, and heck, even chicken wings. Well, there is one necessity that shouldn't cost a ton: taking care of yourself and helping fix all the aches and pains in life. And the fine folks at Titan MRI agree. With costs a fraction of what you'd pay at a hospital, you'll not only save money, you'll be taken care of by staff with over 20 years experience. So when you need an MRI, call Titan first and you can go where your doctors send their families. Now offering CAT scans.
Process Service of Gainesville offers a rapid turnaround on affidavits of service for Gator lawyers locally and nationwide. Our friend Scott Hart offers immediate responses on status requests and is a member of NAPS and FAPS, and he has been a part of the community for almost two decades. Need service? Call Process Service of Gainesville at 407-697-9592 or email shartgators, that's GHTR@yahoo.com. And make sure you ask about the paralegal legal secretary bonus program.
Okay, and welcome back to another Duly Noted podcast presented, of course, by Titan MRI from the Meldon Law Gator Studios. Mm-hmm. And, of course, Meldon Law brings you every Monday. Coach Spurrier, Mondays with Meldon. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And it's great having him in here. And, of course, Gators get a win Saturday. Mm-hmm. Got the job done. There were times when I wasn't overly excited about things, but they got the job done.
Yeah, it was a good game. It wasn't a terrible game. It wasn't anything outlandish. Vandy is still pretty much, seems like Vandy this year. I don't think they'll win a conference game this year. Whereas last year, they beat us and Kentucky last year.
They went, So it feels like they fell back.
Yeah, they've fallen back. Well, the running back at Kentucky was at Vandy last year.
Exactly. Yeah.
You lose a guy like that, it makes a difference. So maybe the good players there, they got more money to go somewhere else, it appears. And that can happen nowadays. So it's if you're a school that doesn't have deep pockets to pay these guys to come play, you're in trouble. They're talking about in the Big 12, Oklahoma and Texas are obviously the two wealthy schools.
Right.
And they look like the two best teams all of a sudden now. So they could easily have a rematch after the game Saturday for the Big 12 championship. So,
yeah, I was somebody was discussing this, and I agreed with them. But they were saying if Texas and Oklahoma were in the SEC this year, where would you rank them? And I go, probably 2 and 3.
Right.
Behind Georgia.
Heck yeah, they're both pretty much undefeated. Well, Texas, somebody had to win or lose that one. But they got the deep pockets, and they look like the two best in the Pac-12 this year. But then again, Texas hadn't won one in 20 years, I think, and Oklahoma hadn't won one in two or three now. or maybe two. So, but Venables, I mean, they went 6-7 last year, same as us.
Yeah.
He went out and got six new defensive linemen, I heard, and a total of about 40 new players at Oklahoma.
Right.
So you can, what they say, upgrade your personnel pretty fast in college football nowadays. That old saying, we got to recruit ourselves out of this. No, you got to pay your way out of it. And that's how you get there quickly.
And that's the thing. There are different ways to build teams. I mean, recruiting is one. I mean, that's what Georgia's done is through recruiting. Mm-hmm. But, again, they've stacked classes.
Yeah.
But nowadays, you can do what Dion did. You can do what Texas used NIL to their advantage. They, mm-hmm. I think all their offensive linemen get $20,000 just for signing.
Mm-hmm.
And you saw what happened with Utah last week. They gave all 85 scholarship players got a brand-new truck. And I'm like,
that's a fair way to do it. So they're not complaining that one guy got all the money.
Yeah,
so
that's right.
I sort of think the NFL has a problem with that when you see guys like Russell Wilson making over $50 million a year, and these other quarterbacks also, and they don't play very well at all, and the whole team, you know, says something's wrong here somehow. But that's part of sports nowadays. Some guys get paid a lot more than others. And if they're not earning their keep, then you have natural dissension hits the ranks.
You know, there's a there's a story in the book Ball Four that where the pitching coach is trying to get this guy to throw the curveball in big spots, but he throws one, and the guy hits a 500-foot homer off of it, and he goes, "Well, not now." And that's what all I could think of is when Florida finally ran a trick play. They ran a trick play, and I was like, well, not now. I mean, obviously the ball floated in the air.
Khalil didn't lead him enough. That was a solid play, but he threw just a little behind him. Yeah.
Yeah, but that's the thing. Trick plays don't always work, and a lot of times they don't work because there's some preciseness that goes into them. So
You got to execute them. But, we had a few of those double passes, and usually a throwback to the quarterback occasionally.
Right.
And our receivers usually threw a good ball.
Yeah. Well, he looked like he had a good arm. He just floated it too much.
Yeah, he took a little too much off. Yeah. He could have hit him. But
the first play you ran at Duke, was that a double reverse pass?
The first play I ran at Duke was a reverse. The halfback he flipped it to the flanker. He came around, flipped it back to the quarterback, and then we flipped it back to the halfback on the screen. I don't think we made much. The Colgate team didn't chase the reverse too much, but we made a few yards. It didn't go backwards anyway.
So is that play not up on the wall in here? Diagram that
so.
one? It's a good one, though. Obviously, all the stuff that happened this week was a wild week, and you were mentioning the Oklahoma-Texas game and Bobby Stoops' son doing really well in that game.
Drake caught a bunch of passes in that victory over Texas. And I tell you what, the more you watch all these games, Pat, you realize one play determines the winner. One or two plays here or there does it. At the end of the game there, when Texas was trying to score, and Oklahoma kids made a great tackle on the 1 yard line or half yard line to prevent Texas from getting a touchdown. And then on the last drive, the touchdown pass, the offensive lineman for Oklahoma, he blocked his guy in a little bit of that linebacker coming around.
Mm-hmm.
They had two on one blocker, and he got a piece of both of them. And Dylan Gabriel was able to get it out, and the guy was open in the back of the end zone there. And that ended up being the play of the game. So I tell you what, that left tackle, he needs credit for sort of blocking both of them at the same time. And then, of course, Dylan Gabriel made a heck of a play the whole game. He was really something. And two other quarterbacks were really outstanding this past week. The Missouri quarterback, LSU quarterback, victory over Missouri, Jaden Daniels. Gee. Man, can he run and he can pass
fly too for a guy that, you know, is just a skinny old
6'4", runs probably a 4.45, and is a good passer. That's the prototype quarterback everybody wants right now. And then the Georgia quarterback, Carson Beck.
Carson Beck had a big day.
He's thrown for over 300 yards three straight games to tie Aaron Murray back in 2011-12, that era. So he's been a good player too there at Georgia.
Yep. You know, it's kind of funny because Florida people are asking themselves, how can Georgia do that to Kentucky? And we could do it. Well, you're playing in different places. Mm-hmm. I mean, obviously, that has something to do with it. But Georgia's really good, you know, and they certainly Kentucky got their attention by handling.
Yeah, there seemed to be peaking right here in the middle of the season because the other games they hadn't looked all that super, but they turned it on against Kentucky.
Was that ever a problem for any of your teams? Like somebody was saying, sometimes you get bored because you're going, like in this case, going for a three-peat. You had to go for three-peats in the SEC, certainly. Mm-hmm.
Well, sometimes you don't play quite as well as you play the other game. And a lot of SEC teams have one loss, and then after that, you get going. And we did that a bunch. Urban's teams had one loss and won national championships after that one loss. So you just hope you don't have two losses. That would knock you out of most everything. But one loss is not bad.
That was the great thing about that 96 team is even though they had gone undefeated the year before up until the Nebraska game, they came back with a purpose. They didn't come back with a, hey, we're the mighty Gators. We want to come back and be better so that we can get into that game again and try to win it.
Yeah, that's true. And that was just a game. Nebraska was way, way better than us every phase of it. And we just regrouped. I mean, we finished second in the nation.
Right.
That's not the worst thing in the world to go 12-1. But we got the rematch, fortunately, because some other teams lost. And we were able to play for the national championship and then, of course, win it. But college football, I tell you what, Pat, every game on TV, the stadium is full, crowds are going crazy. So their lack of interest is not a problem in college football.
No, it's kind of funny that a lot of people go, with this NIL stuff and everything, I'm done with the game.
Yeah.
And then you turn on a game and it's packed, you know.
Oh, yeah.
So people aren't giving up on it. And ticket prices are higher than they've ever been.
Yeah.
And people are still going. But the one place where they're not real happy right now is the University of Miami.
Oh,
I don't know if you saw that. We had turned – the people that were at my house, we had turned it off because we thought the game was over.
Take a knee there.
And if for those of you who don't know, we talked about it earlier, but, you know, just take a knee there. But sometimes you just – I don't know. I don't know what his thinking was, but apparently he did that before. When he was at Oregon, where he didn't take a knee, and a guy fumbled, and they lost, ended up losing the game. So you got to learn from your mistakes, right?
Yeah, they were running out the clock, and he doesn't call the plays, so he just, you know, he's over there just really sort of watching, and they called a run play, and I mean, the fullback, he knows it's in the end of the game, and they got it pretty much won. I don't know how he let it come out, but he did.
Yeah.
And then the DBs, what are they doing back there? So I know the coach gets all the blame, and he deserves a little bit. But, you know, the players were still out there playing. The game was not over. And you try to teach your players, hey, we can overcome our mistakes if we all play our best. So there were some mistakes, you know, made after after he made his mistake.
Yeah, absolutely. But it was – yeah, you're right, because even like, again, I wasn't watching it live when it happened. I went back and just watched it today. But even when they do get the fumble, it's still, they've got to go a long way in a short period of time.
75 yards.
Yeah, and go right down the field in two plays and get it, which was pretty amazing.
It was amazing. It's never over till it's over, as they say.
It never is, Coach. It never is. There were a lot of other great games this weekend, and you know, obviously, you know, the way that the good thing for South Carolina is they had a bye this week, so they could watch everything and be ready for it. But it's kind of a weird game for you because, you know, I mean, obviously you're here, but you coach there as well.
Yeah, both of my old schools are playing, and of course, I'm a Gator now. I'm on the staff. I'm on the payroll a little bit, tiny bit, as an ambassador. So obviously this is my school, but... it's a big game for South Carolina. They're 2-3.
And
I know all the Gators, we're hoping they're going to be 2-4, and we'll go up to 4-2, I think.
5-2.
5-2, yeah. We played one extra game. So anyway, it should be a close one. And whoever plays the best is going to win the game.
Well, and that's pretty the simple thing. You hope you get to that position where you have a chance to win in the fourth quarter. And that's one thing Florida, as we know, hasn't been good on the road. I don't know if there's an answer to how – you can change things up and make things better or make mm-hmm. the team more ready. But certainly the only two road games they played this year, they haven't looked very good.
Yeah, I don't know what he's going to change, but I hope it changes something, even if it's don't go to the movie or pregame meal is going to be later. It's a 3:30 game.
3:30 game, right.
We can't use that excuse. We can't play early in the morning or at noon. One of the guys said they were a little flat, which was a bad excuse.
Yeah.
But, 3:30 game, both teams desperate for a win. Should be a heck of a game.
Should be fun. Mm-hmm. All right. Mm-hmm. You got anything else for us, Coach?
Oh, I think that's about it right now for this week. Oregon and Washington is a big game this week.
Yeah.
Oregon and Washington.
Well, you're talking about 7 and 8.
Yeah.
Yeah. And, oh, yeah, we do have to get to our play of the day brought to you by Campus USA, the play of the weekend that we give it to a different player every week. So we'll see. I think I know who it is this week. I totally forgot what we talked about, mm-hmm. but here it is. Okay, so Montrell Johnson, right? Here he goes. That was a great stutter move there to mm-hmm. wait for the hole to open up. That's one thing I saw about him in the spring. Here's another great run. So we put a montage together of Montrell Johnson because he was so great. But that, mm-hmm. where he knows how to wait and pick the hole, and I think he's really good at that so far this year. I mean, and he's, and again, he stepped up when ETN was mm-hmm. unavailable to go. So that was certainly a good for him to play at that level.
His brother ETN had a big day yesterday.
He did.
Jags winning over in London again, England. They won two games over there. So.
And Treyon Webb had a big game.
Somebody said if they could play like that in Jacksonville, they'd be leading their division.
Yeah, why? That's weird that they play so good over there, but they can't, in Jacksonville.
Yeah, maybe they're peaking now, so maybe they can continue it.
Yeah, absolutely.
Hopefully, yeah.
All right, well, that was our Campus USA play of the weekend. We appreciate that. We appreciate Coach Spurrier for being in, as always. And we'll have a lot to talk about next week, I know, Coach, after the South Carolina game. Because I want to see, for Florida to play well on the road, they're going to have to play well on the road. And then I'll believe it. But I have to see it.
You know, we're not in bad shape. We're not in great shape, but we're not in bad because we just had one conference loss to Kentucky. And Kentucky's probably going to lose another one. So if we can run the table and beat Georgia,
we'll be
in a conference championship game. Just got to win all the conference games.
You got to win this one. Yeah. If you win this one, then I think people get excited again.
Yeah,
you
would have a chance. That's right.
We'll see how it goes.
Huge game.
Mm-hmm. All right, that is Coach Spurrier on a Meldon Monday. We appreciate his time. We'll be back with Robbie Andrew for Yes, Nowhere, Maybe here on another Dooley Noted podcast presented by Titan MRI from the Meldon Law Gator Studios.
Hello there, everybody. I'm Pat Dooley, of course, from another Dooley Noted podcast. And this is a great Adam Brewer, and he's just opened up a place here, Adam Brewer To Go. What gave you the idea to do this, to have a to-go place?
We really like the fast concept, being able to get the barbecue. Now we have this new online ordering. So before it was a call ahead, carry out, quick service. We have like a curbside kind of a deal where everything's ready to go for you. And then we thought, wow, we have a really great dine-in concept, but how can we make this streamlined for the customer and make it easy and accessible for all parts of town?
Adam's Rib Co. To Go. Come on down and enjoy it.
Gator fans, football season is here. What's better than seeing the Gators back on the field? Easy. Seeing amazing speakers and fellow Gator fans weekly at the Gainesville Quarterback Club. Held every Tuesday night of a home game at the Best Western Gateway Grand. Enjoy happy hour, great food, valuable insights from yours truly and Andy Staples, plus notable speakers throughout the season. As the oldest Gator booster club in the world, Gainesville Quarterback Club gives you access to elite speakers like coaches, NCAA football insiders, Gator greats, and more. Share your passion for Gator football with hundreds of other members at weekly in-season meetings, home tailgates, and special events throughout the year. Join the Gainesville Quarterback Club today. Email the club at membership
@quarterbackclub.org or visit thequarterbackclub.org, or better yet, just give me a call and I'll get you to the right people.
Great food, great atmosphere, a diverse menu, everything made from scratch, plenty of space, and locally owned. These are all the characteristics of a great restaurant, and you can find each and every one of them right here in Gainesville at Ballyhoo Grill. Ballyhoo Grill prepares all of their food fresh every day, from their salad dressing to their award-winning soups. Bring your family and enjoy dinner under the Tim Tribo Tiki Hut while listening to live music. Or if you're running low on time to eat out, they also deliver through Uber Eats, Fight Squad, and Postmates. A Gainesville staple that's been open for over 30 years. Check out Ballyhoo Grill on Facebook or at ballyhoogrill.com.
Okay, and welcome back to another Dooley Noted podcast presented by Titan MRI from the Meldon Law Gator Studios. We go to our Big Mills Cheesesteak Zoom line and bring in Robbie Andrew, who we usually bring in on Mondays. Robbie, did you enjoy your Saturday of watching college football?
Yeah, it was a lot of fun, Pat. A lot of good games. So most entertaining game to me was the Missouri game, LSU. Jaden Daniels is the best player in the country.
I think LSU should be required to play two games a week so we can watch them. Because they can't play defense.
Yeah, they're entertaining.
Maybe we need an LSU-USC bowl game, because it may end up like 90-85 or something. Because neither one of them can play
defense.
That'd
be a fun one.
Yeah. It was a lot of fun. There were a lot of good games. Those games at noon, I'm just sitting there and I got the two TVs going. I'm like, this is good. This is really good. This is exactly what you want. You want two great games going on at the same time.
That last drive by Oklahoma was unbelievable.
A little Stoopsie in there. Got a little Stoopsie.
Yeah.
All right. Coach Spurrier was saying earlier, he was in here, he was saying he saw Bobby the other day. All right, Robbie, it is time for us to play Yes, Nowhere, Maybe, brought to you by Big Mills Cheesesteak. Street dining done the right way. If you go in there and say you listen to or watch another Dooley Noted podcast, you will be able to get free fries with your order. So we appreciate Big Mills Cheesesteaks. Number one, Robbie, Florida. It's now 4-2. They will go to a bowl game. With six games left, they only need to win twice.
I'll say maybe on that one, Pat. I mean, it's going to be hard, though, because they can't win on the road so far. And now you've got to play, Missouri on the road, South Carolina on the road this week.
Four of the last six are away from the swamp, yeah.
Yeah, so it's going to be hard. You know, the only win I see is Arkansas at home, maybe. That could be the only one left out there for them.
Well,
so maybe they're going to have to get a lot better on the road.
You're playing a 2-3 team this week, but I don't think, and again, South Carolina's a 2-point favorite. I don't think there's a lot of people with a lot of confidence, only because we've not seen it on the road. We have not seen this team go out and play well on the road, or even play average on the road.
Well, the one exception was the A&M game last year. They actually played really well in the second half and won that game. They need to play like that with that kind of confidence. The problem is they get off to terrible starts on the road. That's been the problem.
Yeah, I know, and it's hard to – I mean, what do you do? What do you change? I know that Billy Napier will be changed. Something will be different about their routine. I'm sure they're going to change something. I don't know what it is. Maybe different.
Well, I think one thing, Pat, they said they're going to get up to South Carolina earlier and then get to the stadium earlier. So I don't know if that's going to help or not.
Well, you got to do something different. That's for sure. All right.
Oh, yeah.
Number two, the Miami mishap, as I'm liking to call it, that happened, it was very Doug Dickey-like. Not taking a knee and instead fumbling and losing the game on two plays later. One of the most bizarre things I've ever seen. But Yes, Nowhere, Maybe, it was very Doug Dickey-like.
Yeah, yes, it was, Pat. Because, Doug Dickey made some bonehead plays, like the fourth and dumb in 76 against Georgia, and a lot of bad play calling over his career, but nothing as bad as this.
Yeah, I just don't know what the mentality would have been other than just a knee.
I mean, you take a knee and the game is over.
Over. They were like 33 seconds, I think, when they fumbled. So if you take a knee, they have no more timeouts. That qualifies as the game being over.
Yeah, the game is over. I don't get it.
I'm just happy that it happened.
Yeah, but and that's like one of the most shocking losses you're ever going to experience if you have one like that. That was unbelievable.
Yeah, absolutely.
I mean, the fumble was bad, Pat, but so was the coverage on that last play.
Oh, I know.
How do you let a guy run behind you?
Way behind you.
Yeah.
It was almost like
it was easy.
I thought I saw Tyree Cleveland running out there.
Yeah. He was covered compared to this guy.
That's right. All right, number three on yes, no way, or maybe with Robbie Andrew. Robbie, you miss making those trips to Columbia, South Carolina, which we used to do every other year for a long time.
I'll say maybe a little bit, Pat, but, you know, I don't regret that I'm not going up there, that's for sure. But we always had fun because it was a trip you could drive to and hang out and go out to dinner the night before. And so I always liked that trip. It was one of my favorites, really.
Any trip that doesn't involve the Atlanta airport's a good trip.
Flying. Right? Yeah.
Doesn't involve flying is a good trip. I do miss, so that's exactly. The one game I do kind of miss. I miss going to Lexington too, because it's just, I miss going to Lexington when it was cold, they were playing in October and October and early November, because it was
another trip I love. Yeah. Another trip I loved was the Auburn trip. We didn't get to do that many times because of the switch in the conference. So that was always a great road trip too.
Yeah, it was. We had a lot of fun. We never would stay in Auburn, of course.
No.
There are no hotels there. There's a couple.
We stayed in Columbus, right?
Yep, Columbus.
Yeah.
Which, all pawn shops and traffic lights, that city. But we would find ways to have fun.
Yeah, they had a great walk along the river, though. That was the best part.
Yeah, absolutely. All right, Robbie, we'll let you go on yes,
okay,
no
Pat.
Way.
I'll see you later this week.
See you, bud.
Okay.
Okay, well, appreciate Robbie for joining us, as he always does, on Yes, Nowhere, or maybe on Mondays. We always love doing that. We'll hopefully be playing it Thursday with Danny Werfel. But we'll be doing the show from my house, of course, on Thursdays. And again, like I said earlier, no show the following Thursday. All right, we have a lot of things to get to, as we always do this time of day. You know, it's funny. I was just a little bit earlier today, I was in the restroom. I know you don't want to hear about that, but I was in the restroom. And the song came on the radio, Where the Streets Have No Name, the U2 song, which was the opening for Gator basketball during its heyday. And it got you fired up, and it was loud, and it was just perfect song for that Billy Donovan group. And I'm like, well, why not go back to that? It was the best thing. We loved it. Go back to it. And I think there was a one game where they did play it just to kind of try to wake up the echoes, but they should do it all the time. Anyway, all right. Let's get to our Adams Ribco to Go Gator of the Weekend. And, of course, we had several we could have chosen from. I know Soccer Tide, Georgia 0-0. That one must have been fun to cover. Volleyball got the sweep on Sunday after getting swept on Friday by Auburn. That was at home. That was a little bit of a surprise. Anyway, there was a lot of football going on, everything. Here's who I decided to make our Adams Ribco to Go Gator of the Weekend, and that's Jaden Hill, the defensive back who I thought had a huge game, recovered a fumble, had several pass breaks. It seemed like he kept making plays. Now, again, I know it was Vanderbilt, okay? You're going to be playing against a little bit better wide receivers. Although, I mean, Will Shepard is as good as there is in this league. And, of course, he's the one who on the first 85-yard, or was it 85 or 85-yard touchdown, grabbed Jason Marshall's. That's unbelievable. He grabbed his face mask and tugged it down so Jason Marshall has to stop to get his head, you know, so he can see. And then he catches the touchdown pass and he's gone. You still could have chased him, Jason. You didn't have to just give up. That was pretty weak. But anyway, but Jaden Hill, I thought, played really well for this game. And he's been pretty solid, really, since coming back from that injury last year. But he is our Adams Ribco to Go Gator of the Weekend. Let's jump to our Leonardo's at Millhopper quick picks. I did hear from our last winner, Keith, and he and I are going to meet at some point, so I can give him all his stuff. But unfortunately, when he's coming, I'm not going to be here. We'll get it all worked out, though. We know that. So here we go. And we did have a little glitch last week. So a lot of, and I could, the reason I could tell is I wasn't getting a lot of quick picks in. So we got it fixed. And then several of them came in. But there weren't a lot of qualifiers. But we're trying to give you these Thursday games as the, as Leonardo's at Millhopper quick picks. So we're going to give you this one. West Virginia is giving 3 at Houston. Interesting game there. West Virginia, Neil Brown probably has saved his job with as good as they played. So we'll keep an eye on that. But, now you have a reason to watch Thursday night game like that. I'll be watching. I can tell you that. Believe me, the NFL game's not very good. And you have to go to Prime Video, which means you can't turn the channel unless you want to have to take 5 minutes to come back. So not going to do it. All right, that is our Leonardo's at Millhopper quick picks. Actually playing golf Thursday with Kyle from Leonardo's in the Stop Children's Cancer Tournament. Friday, I'm sorry. I said Thursday, I meant Friday. Friday when we're doing that. Although it's supposed to rain, so keep your fingers crossed. All right, let's get to our Swamp Games of the Week. And, of course, Jeff Cardoza was out there with Zach on Thursday because I was in Palaka speaking to that group, and we had a good time over there. And so it'll only two more chances to come out and see us at the Swamp Restaurant, two more home games. This won't be one, obviously, but be interesting to see what kind of crowd they get at the Swamp for a game like this, because road games, I don't know. 3:30 road games is the kind of game you like to go out and see at a place like the Swamp. Don't get down on the Gators being how badly they play on the road. It's about to shift. I'm telling you. It's going to change. I tell you. All right. Here, let's give you the games. Okay. Braysville's today, 6:07 start on TBS. You know, let's score some runs. And then Arizona LA Dodgers is at, it says 9:07 on TBS, which means it could very well be on a different channel and they have to move it around like they do with ESPN. Anyway, that's today. Tuesday, you've got all four. No, you've got Houston, Minnesota's Tuesday on Fox, and then Baltimore at Texas is 8:07 on Fox. And then there's four games Wednesday if they're all, yeah. So that'll be cool. The Thursday game is Denver at Kansas City on Prime Video in the NFL. See what I said there? I told you it wasn't a good game. Kansas City's really good. Denver's not. Okay, that makes for bad games. All right, so those are our Swamp Games of the Week. It's going to be an interesting weekend as well. Let's get to our Hesser and Kipke three things. I've been hearing from Ken a lot. He's up in Atlanta and, you know, where I wish I was, but he's up there with his Phil stuff on. We're just going to agree not to agree on anything this week. I was actually at his house last year when they won game 4, Phillies. I didn't want to play him, but you got to beat him sometime. All right, Hesser and Kipke is a Gainesville law firm specializing in the area of workers' compensation and family law. Ken and Jennifer take great pride in their one-to-one focus on each and every client they represent. Ken is board certified in workers' compensation law by the Florida Bar, while Jennifer possesses extensive jury trial experience with a nearly 20-year background as a prosecutor. Don't believe me? Well, check out their 5-star Google reviews. Set an appointment at hklawfl.com, or better yet, give them a call at 352-339-9920, Hesser and Kipke. All right, number one was the game last night. San Francisco just bludgeoned Dallas. And now Dallas fans are like, well, maybe we aren't that good. You know, they're trying to figure out what's going on. I always love it, though, when players, and this was an offensive lineman that said it, but say, this is not what we are. This is not indicative of who we are. This is not what our team is. It's in your baggage. It's part of it. When you pack that bag, you got to pack that game away and put it in there. It's part of who you are. To be able to lose a game 42-10, that's, you know, you can say that Florida is not the way they play on the road. That's not the team there. Well, they played 2 games on the road and stunk them both up. So that's got to go in the suitcase. I'm sorry. It's part of who you are if you can allow a game like that to happen. Number two on Hesser and Kipke's three things. Really a shame, Anthony Richardson again with an injury. This time it's his shoulder, and had to leave the game. He's going to have a second opinion. And it was funny when I saw the story, because it was Keith Meister is the guy who's looking at him. And, of course, Keith Meister was the – I think he was a baseball team surgeon or – yeah, when here at Florida for a long time, and actually got to know him pretty well. Haven't talked to him in forever, though. It's been a long time, but that's who he's coming to see. But, you know, it is a shame because you've got this incredible talent. You want to use him the right way if you're Indianapolis, but if you use him the right way, he's probably going to get hurt. He got hurt at Florida. Obviously, the hamstring is, you know, kept him from maybe having some starts. That would have been 3 years ago, 2 years ago, or last year, I'm sorry, 2 years ago. Last year, he had an ankle that kept bothering him. He had a bunch of aches and that would slow him down. I think made him hard for him to run sometimes, and maybe didn't make him want to run. But what are you going to do when you're that good at running the football? So I don't know. I mean, hopefully they say it may be out for a significant amount of time. We'll have to see how that shoulder comes around. And finally, these are all NFL three things. I'm staying away from baseball. I don't want to talk about it till we win a game. Nathaniel Hackett's revenge game was a beauty with the Jets winning that game. And this is why you don't say dumb things like Sean Payton said. You don't say dumb things like it was the worst coaching job ever coaching Russell Wilson last year. You know, but you're going to have to play them later in the year. Don't say that. It's got to know. We want you. The funny thing is, we want you to be colorful, but when you're too colorful, it'll come back to bite you. But one reason we want you to be comfortable is because we want the controversy. You know, we don't want you to be bored. Anyway, that's our Hesser and Kipke three things. Let us get to our Gainesville Quarterback Club. Great picks. Great pick that they made for their speaker tomorrow night, Tuesday night. Chris Doering will be there. Can't wait to hear what he's got to say. Love it when he's there. And, of course, the great picks. I am not doing well. I had a bad, bad, bad weekend. I went 1-6. That's hard to do. It's almost impossible to do. So I'm now back to below 500 for the year. I'm losing money if I was really betting. 17-18-1. Thanks for nothing. All right, let's get to them. UTEP, and we're going to pick in the early games. UTEP at FIU. FIU's getting 1.5. I'm going to take UTEP in that one. The West Virginia game I mentioned earlier. West Virginia is a 2.5-point favorite at Houston. I'm going to take West Virginia. That's not much of a favorite on the road. It's probably a bad choice, but I'm still going West Virginia. And then I'm also taking a road dog, SMU, minus 11 at East Carolina. East Carolina has really fallen off. They're not very good, to be honest with you. Okay, so that is our Gainesville Quarterback Club great picks, and those are mine for this week. Last week, they weren't great picks. They were bad picks. I had the worst beat, too. I had LSU minus 6.5. I had Missouri in that game, and they run back a pick six on the last play. Yeah. So I would have lost money on that game. That made me very mad. But anyway, all right. Good. Now I understand the pain of a bad beat, even though I didn't actually gamble. Let's get to Pat Dooley's story time, which as always is brought to you by our good friends at Eastlake Pediatrics. We appreciate them. I could tell two South Carolina stories, but I'm just going to tell this one, okay? And this was in, I don't even know, I can't remember what year it was. Whatever year that Auburn had the two amazing games. They had the deflected pass that and the guy ended up catching. What'd they call that one? And then they had the kick.
The kick six.
Kick six.
Probably like 13, 14 maybe.
Yeah. So that anyway, we're watching the Georgia Auburn game. We really have no skin in who's winning. And that play, we've got it on my computer in the press box. And at the same time, right about the same time it happens, Florida gets a first down on a play. I think it was Kelvin Taylor who ran for a first down. I think it was him. Anyway, maybe it wasn't him. So they get a first down, and at the very moment, this play happens where the ball gets deflected up in the air and the guy runs for a touchdown. You're just like, and Robbie is like, whoa! look at, oh. And all of a sudden we hear over the loudspeakers, gentlemen, just a reminder, there is no cheering allowed in the press box. And like, we're not cheering this game. We're cheering this game on the TV. But technically, they're kind of right. Never supposed to cheer for any reason, right? But we couldn't help ourselves, and I wouldn't do it over again. Maybe I'll tell you some other South Carolina stories. Well, let me tell you this one real quick, okay? Now, I'll give you a short version. Karen and I are there. Robbie and his brother Tim were all there partying in a room Friday night before the game. And that's the night that Karen got the nickname Shot Girl. This is 95 because for some reason we were doing Jack Daniel shots. And to my life of me, I have no idea why. But anyway, we were a little loud and everything. We never heard it from anybody, though. So, you know, obviously wouldn't bother anybody. And the next day, we come out of the room to go to the game, and we realize players are coming out to get ready to get on the bus. And the door opens next to our room, and we get up, and it's Werfel and Doering. And we're like, oh, these guys probably hate our guts. I'm going to bring that story up to Doering tomorrow night when I introduce him. All right. We're done, right? That's going to do it for another Dooley Noted podcast for another day here on, of course, presented to you by Titan MRI. I'm losing my trains of thoughts. They're going in and out. And again, we're coming to you from the Meldon Law Gator Studios. We'll be back with another show on Thursday. Again, I think Danny Werfel is going to be with us, so that'll be a lot of fun. Maybe we'll bring that story up to him. He's probably trying to pray for us at that point, the way we were sounding. We'll be back. Thanks again to Zach for doing a great job producing. Until next time, I am Pat Dooley. I am deep. I'm way back. And I am out of here.
Another Dooley Noted podcast comes to you from the Coach's Podcast Room at Spurrier's Gridiron Grill in Celebration Point. You can watch and listen to us on Facebook and YouTube for every podcast that we do on Mondays and Fridays at 2 o'clock. Listen to the podcast whenever on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Google Podcasts, Overcast, any of the other 39 platforms where you can find this podcast or your favorite podcast. Remember to like, follow, and subscribe. If you have any questions or comments, leave them in the comments section below or call me if you want to do some advertising at 352-317-3444.